Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Tibetan Buddhism, A Very Short Introduction, by Matthew T. Kapstein, narrated by Neil Shah.
Chapter 1. The World of Gods, Demons, and Men. One early spring day in the mid-1970s, at the residence of a Tibetan Lama in the remote mountains of Nepal, I was invited to take tea and to converse with my learned host on the challenging topic of the nature of consciousness in Buddhist philosophy. As we pondered a difficult passage from an 8th century Indian text, asserting that the mind cannot be an object to itself, we were abruptly interrupted by the Lama's servant. He whispered to the teacher that a local couple had arrived with urgent business. Could he please usher them in? Consent was granted, and the couple, peasants who had some herds that they tended in the pastures above the monastery, entered, pallid and visibly quaking with fear. The night before, a demon had entered their cattle shed, kicking up sparks and crackling, and almost provoked a stampede. What evil deed had they committed to become the objects of such demonic fury? And now that the bane was upon them, how was it to be appeased? Prostrating themselves before the Lama, they begged for his protection and placed a small handful of cash on his table as an offering, together with a bowl brimming with fresh curds from their cows. The Lama immediately sought to put their minds at ease. Seating them, he called for tea and biscuits to be served. After having them repeat in detail what had transpired, and by now I thought I recognized within the demonic attack an occurrence of the strange meteorological phenomenon sometimes called ball lightning, he took up his astrological almanac. Studying it for some minutes, he rolled the divination dice he always kept close at hand and counted off numerological combinations on his rosary. After what must have seemed an eternity to the terrified couple, he leaned forward and addressed them in the soothing tones of a parent comforting a frightened child. "There are no indications that anything grave has occurred. Your livestock will be fine," he explained. "Neither you nor your children will be afflicted with demon-born sickness or similar ills. Only a passing disturbance of the elements, due to the minor faults of past karma, is at stake. To purify your karma and to pacify these troubles, you must undertake to practice each day the rite of sang, incense fumigation dedicated to the spirits of the environment, and to recite Om Mani Padme Hum, the mantra of Avalokiteshvara, the Bodhisattva of compassion, 1,000 times. Do this and your problems will vanish. Above all, do not be afraid. Keep faith. Adhere to compassion. You and those close to you will surely soon be free from all that has caused this distress." The Lama then gave them knotted protection cords, some consecrated pills, a sip of perfumed water, and touching each on the crown of the head, recited some prayers on their behalf. The couple, still nervous but braving hopeful expressions, took their leave. The Lama looked up, smiled gently, and said, "Where were we? Mind cannot see mind, wasn't it?" Religion's Two Ends. Tibetan Buddhism, as it is presented in the West, is often treated as an erudite spiritual discipline, a world of subtle philosophy and high-powered techniques of abstract meditation, dispensing a bounty of insight and compassion to all. Although this representation has its basis in the image that Tibetan Buddhism has carefully crafted of itself through the centuries, for Tibetans generally, including the social and religious elites, avoiding bad karma and demonic disturbances and undertaking meritorious rites and purifications were the fundamental objectives of religious life. Far from seeking to transcend the world in attainments of mystical contemplation, the day-to-day concerns that motivated the religious lives of most Tibetans, laymen and clergy alike, were the problems inherent in maintaining, not transcending, the order of the world by ensuring that harvests were plentiful, cattle productive, children sound, and enemies, whether demonic or human, impotent. Religious professionals, accordingly, were expected to minister to these and similar needs, whatever they might have to say about recondite topics like the nature of mind. Where the two ends of Tibetan religion, world maintenance and world transcendence, met was in the ideal of the Lama, the spiritually accomplished teacher, often regarded as a bodhisattva who, in virtue of his superior compassion, learning, and ritual virtuosity, was both motivated and prepared to act in the service of the world at large. It goes without saying that not all who were titled Lama, in fact, fulfilled this lofty ideal, though many surely strove to do so. The bread-and-butter concerns of the Tibetan Buddhist clergy required that they devote considerable efforts to realizing the broad range of ritual demands for the protection, peace, and prosperity of their patrons, and to furnishing them with divinations and astrological consultations. In encountering Tibetan Buddhism as it is presented in many works on religious teaching, which tend to emphasize doctrines and contemplative practices, one rarely finds even oblique references to those ubiquitous aspects of Tibetan religion as it is lived. Not surprisingly, there has been a marked discrepancy between descriptions of Tibetan Buddhism based primarily on doctrinal texts and those derived from anthropological studies of life in traditional Tibetan and Himalayan communities. This introduction, though stressing the textual record of history, doctrine, and practice, nevertheless also attempts to recall pertinent facts on the ground, as these are known from observing the actual religious life of Tibet. Writings on Tibetan religion sometimes distinguish sharply between Buddhism, originally an Indian religion that came to dominate Tibetan culture from the late first millennium on, and Bon, described as the ancient indigenous religion of Tibet. This characterization is not without its problems, however, and it will be one of the tasks for the chapters that follow to provide greater precision about this. For the moment, though, it should be noted that the canonical scriptures of the Bon religion, in contrast to those of mainstream Tibetan Buddhism, have much to say about the world-maintaining facets of Tibetan religious life as those have been, in fact, practiced. Accordingly, it is worthwhile to attend in brief to what Bon sources have to say about this. It must be constantly borne in mind that these matters are no less relevant to Tibetan Buddhism, despite the latter's relative theological silence about them. In practice, adherents of both Bon and Buddhism are equally concerned with maintaining harmony with local spirits and demons, with avoiding spiritual pollution and acquiring tokens imbued with blessings of auspicious good fortune, and with rites of passage that begin when a lama whispers a name into an infant's ear and concludes with one's departure at death. Between gods and demons. In recognizing appearance to be a divinity, La, and thus beneficent, or a demon, Dre, and thus harmful, one comes to realize that all of birth and death are fashioned by divinities and demons, La Dre. In these words, a 12th century Bon text summarizes the human predicament in its most essential features. We inhabit a world in which invisible powers, capable of helping or hurting us, are omnipresent. It is therefore imperative that we recognize these powers for what they are and learn how best to determine our own course in relation to them. The same work explains in brief how one deals with malefic spirits, which are regarded as perfectly analogous to the causes of disease. Nor are the worldly divinities, in contrast to the implacable demons, considered as inherently well-disposed to human beings. They are characterized as often arrogant and vengeful, but nevertheless respectful of Bon and attached to the Shen, the Bon priesthood. The relation the latter seek to form with these proud and powerful beings is therefore one of mastery and coercion, for just as a master puts a slave to work, the practitioner, like the master, realizes the deities and their factotums to be like slaves and servants. Despite the explicit mention of Bon and its priesthood here, these words may be applied in mainstream Buddhist contexts as well. Padmasambhava, the famed Indian master who visited Tibet during the 8th century and is believed to have played a cardinal role in the implantation there of Buddhism, legendarily converted many of the arrogant Tibetan divinities to Buddhism, coercing them to act as protectors of the foreign religion. Numbers of later Buddhist masters then followed his example. We read, for instance, of an 11th century adept, Surchungpa, who vanquished the Lu, Nagas, or serpent demons, in the vicinity of his teacher, Surpoche's temple, forcing them to produce a tribute of chang, the rich barley ale that was a staple of the Tibetan diet. Surchungpa intentionally summoned the sister of Naga demon who dwelt on the rock at Yaze Trakjong. A thin snake appeared, which Surchungpa turned into a fair lady by means of his gaze. At that, Surpoche said, "I want you to make the ale for the consecration of my temple." The resulting ale was said to flow without limit. Though few Tibetans presume to coerce the spirits in this way, to live, so far as is possible, in harmony with the gods and demons, is nevertheless the concern of all. In one village I visited, I learned that several households had recently experienced a string of misfortunes, giving rise to collective worries in regard to the well-being of the village as a whole. When the leading lama in the region was consulted about it, he determined that the particular Lu associated with the village spring was displeased, his shrine having been left to fall into disrepair and thus desecrated. The shrine of the Lu was accordingly cleansed, refurbished, and consecrated anew, the rites being performed by Buddhist monks from the lama's monastery. In short, without the cooperation of the local spirits, the community cannot hope to achieve prosperity. Without the prosperity of the community, the material basis for religious achievement is lost. And without achievement in religious practice and learning, the cooperation of the local spirits cannot be won. This cycle of interdependence undergirds the religious life of Tibet in all its aspects, whether in settings denoted as Buddhist or Bon, whether on the level of the modest village, or, in past times, of the Tibetan state under the leadership of the Dalai Lamas. On dealing with demons and disease. Living beings are subject to many sorts of afflictions due to spirits and the like. One practices in order to remove these afflictions by means of divination and exorcism. Because beings are subject to many diseases of fever and chill, etc., one enters the way in order to alleviate those illnesses by medicine and treatment. When the effects of disease or afflicting spirits have appeared, one investigates what harm has occurred and what sort of disease or afflicting spirit is present. You diagnose a disease by examining pulse and urine, while afflicting spirits are investigated by means of divination and omens. Without halting the application of medicine and treatment to the effects of disease, you seek to bring about benefits, and without halting their application to the effects of afflicting spirits, you seek to bring about benefits through various divinations and exorcisms. This is the way of practical action. The view realized here resembles that of a scout on a mountain pass who spies out all enemies and dangers, and so brings about their avoidance or removal. Similarly, in this case, you realize, with respect to disease, that it may be treated and cured, and with respect to afflicting spirits, that they may be impeded and deflected. From the Commentary of the Four Clever Men. A Rite of Purification. The divine and demonic fauna of Tibet are remarkably diverse and prolific. One finds, accordingly, an abundant body of techniques, ritual and divinatory, deployed in the constant struggle required in order to sustain the balance of the spiritual ecology. Included here are practices as varied as pilgrimage, spirit channeling, dramatic dances, and offerings of numerous kinds, and an elaborate material culture requiring the production of a great panoply of ritual objects including masks, prayer flags, votive cakes, colorful thread crosses, and much more. As an example of Tibet's this-worldly religion, one specific, very common type of ritual may be considered sang, or incense fumigation, the regular practice of which was urged upon the couple whose cattle fell victim to demonic attack. Sang, literally purification, is a ubiquitous Tibetan custom in which the fragrant smoke of juniper and other substances is offered to the gods and spirits pervading the land. The term sang may be etymologically related to another word, also pronounced song, which forms part of the Tibetan term for the enlightened one, the Buddha, Sangye. Here it refers to the Buddha's awakening as a sloughing off of the sleep of ignorance that characterizes the mundane world. Sang, as fumigation, analogously, offers a cleansing fragrance to the spirits, purifying the taints of the environment that they find distasteful. The custom is almost certainly of indigenous origin in Tibet and adjacent regions, and is practiced in one form or another by virtually all Tibetans, monks and laypersons, men and women, rich and poor. One of the great annual festivals, Jamling Chisang, performed in the early summer on the full moon day of the fifth lunar month, is its greatest elaboration, offering, literally, a general fumigation on behalf of all the spirits of the world. In settled villages, many houses will have a special furnace, a sangtab, placed on the roof or in the courtyard for the regular performance of song. While at long-term nomadic encampments, such a furnace may be constructed outside the tents. It is an offering that in its most basic form is barely a ritual at all. One burns a bit of juniper while reciting a formula such as Lia Giel Lo, the gods are victorious, and perhaps a few mantras, like the ubiquitous Om Mani Padme Hum. Tibetan understandings of Sang cohere closely with beliefs regarding to the character of the local divinities, particularly the mountain gods. These are beings of great power, but also olfactory sensitivity. It is for this reason, for instance, that there is a widespread cultural ban on grilling or roasting meat, which may bring about spiritual pollution, or drip. Although the already limited Tibetan culinary arts thereby suffer for this reason, raw, dried, or boiled meat, as in a stew or soup, are de rigueur, for the gods frown upon those who offend them with the stench of burning flesh. Sweet juniper smoke, however, they find suitable. Moreover, one must offer a particular type of juniper that does not spark or pop when it burns. Explosions, bright flashes, and sharp sounds disrupt the dignified tranquility of the divinities no less, as we have seen, than they do the peace of cattle and men. When they are well pleased, the gods become propitious, and the human community thrives under the resulting favorable auspices, trashi. The gods, irascible though they may be, are drawn to virtue, gewa, and to the merit, sonam, thereby accumulated. They shun evil and pollution, dikdrip. The practice of song, like virtually all that touches upon the cults of the Tibetan indigenous deities, came within the orbit of tantric Buddhism no later than the 12th century and perhaps much earlier. The esoteric ritual scriptures, or tantras, of Indian Buddhism provided the ritual technology for sublimating and organizing autochthonous beliefs and practices in regard to all manners of spirits, divine or demonic, and so quickly pervaded both Buddhist and Bon milieu. Formalized liturgies for the performance of popular rites such as song appeared, in which they were elaborated beyond the simple customs described earlier. Part of one such liturgy for the performance of song, composed during the 16th century, reads as follows. In a great vessel of diverse precious gems are sacramental substances, worldly enjoyments, consecrated as Gnostic ambrosia by three mantra syllables. This lively mix, an appealing offering, I dedicate to the gurus, divinities, goddesses, and protectors, to the lords of our earth and the guests among the six classes to whom I'm indebted. In particular, to those who steal life and longevity, elemental spirits bringing disease, demons, and obstacles, and all types of bad dreams, evil signs and omens, irascible spirits and lords of miraculous powers, creditors seeking food, abode and wealth, lords of pollution and madness, demons of death and their consorts, vampires and spirits of plague, demonesses of town and country, as many as there are throughout the expanses of space. May my sins and obscurations, accumulated throughout the three times, my illicit enjoyment of the wealth of the Sangha and of the deceased, be purified by this fire offering. May each particle of each flame, filling space, become an inexhaustible mass of good offerings, pervading all the fields of the Buddhas. May the gift of this offering in the flames, Gnostic light, pervade the abodes of the six classes down to the lowest hell, and may all beings awaken as Buddhas in the heart of enlightenment. This text addresses Tibetan religious experience on several levels. It seeks to appease and restore order to the elemental spirits bringing disease, demons, and obstacles, while at the same time conferring gnosis, the realization of the Buddha's enlightenment, on all abodes of the six classes, gods, anti-gods, humans, animals, ghosts, and denizens of hell, inhabiting the round of rebirth, or samsara. In its aspiration for the salvation of all beings, it adheres to the cardinal values of Mahayana Buddhism, while in its use of spell-like mantras to consecrate the juniper and other substances offered into the flames as Gnostic ambrosia for the practice of sangha, it adopts the ritual usages of Buddhist tantra. It forms a tapestry of sorts in which the Tibetan world of gods, demons, and men, the Mahayana Buddhist orientation to universal enlightenment, and the ritual technologies of tantric esotericism are tightly interwoven. In actual practice, the very themes that may be identified here are most often inseparable, forming for Tibetans a balanced whole, whose several parts, in both their historical and doctrinal aspects, are indissociable. Chapter 2. Sources of Tibetan Religious Traditions. The Introduction of Buddhism to Tibet. It is not clear when Tibetans first encountered the Buddhist religion. Tradition holds that it was in the time of La Tothari, circa 4th century CE, a ruler of Yarlung in southeastern Tibet. Buddhist scriptures and images are related to have miraculously fallen upon his palace, though others say they were offered by a wandering Central Asian Buddhist monk. Although these are legends, it is not implausible that elements of Buddhism arrived during this period of Tibetan prehistory. Tibet was then surrounded by lands in which Buddhism was a long-established religious and cultural system. Nepal and India to the south, China to the east, the Silk Road states to the north, and the pre-Islamic Iranian world to the west. Tibetan history begins with the Tsenpo, or Emperor Song Tsengampo, circa 617 to 49, who militarily and politically unified the Tibetan plateau and began the conquest of surrounding lands. The Tibetan system of writing, based on Indian models, was developed at this time. The emperor's marriage to the Chinese princess Wan Chang, death 680, is believed to have been accompanied by the installation in his capital city, Lhasa, of a precious image of Shakyamuni Buddha brought from China as part of her dowry and said to have been manufactured in India as a portrait of the Buddha himself. The statue, known as Joeo, Lord, remains Tibet's holiest object of pilgrimage. Later accounts relate that the monarch also married a Nepalese Buddhist princess, Barkuti, and that inspired by his two foreign queens, he and his court embraced the Indian religion. Indeed, Song Tsengampo would be eventually regarded as a Tibetan emanation of the regal bodhisattva of universal compassion, Avalokiteshvara, or Chenresi in Tibetan, who was believed to have been entrusted by the Buddha Shakyamuni with the task of converting Tibet. Although Song Tsengampo extended some degree of tolerance to Buddhism, at least in order to accommodate his foreign brides, it is unlikely that the alien faith made much progress in Tibet before another half century or more had passed. Under the king Tri Dusong, death 704, a temple was found in the region of Ling, in far eastern Tibet, perhaps in connection with military campaigns in the southeastern part of the Tibetan Empire against the Buddhist kingdom.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.